To Bunny's Designs, this is a live show recorded for Ustream.tv and also for YouTube for people to watch at their leisure. It's live Thursday with live people, so I'm having a natter in chat. I've been attacked by the Amazon gremlin, which left these wonderful Derwent watercolour pencils on the way to me. I have an old set which looked like this. And they seem to be a bit waxy. I've done a comparison. They seem to be not as scratchy, but of course these pencils are still gorgeous and these are old. The wax might have changed, the wood's changed, because I mean mine are, you know, a good few years old. I would think they may be vintage, they're that old. But with new technology and with wood and forest protection, different companies, especially pencil companies and furniture companies that deal with natural wood, have had to rearrange what they use. So this is natural. It doesn't look quite as nice, but it's still quite gorgeous. The pigments seem to be very similar. I had a bit of a play, haven't noticed any difference. As well as the Derwent watercolour pencils, the Coombe Extra Length Long Point pencil sharpener also jumped into my Amazon trolley. And that's what it does if you don't sharpen it. If you sharpen it with number one, it takes the wood off. If I want to take that to a very sharp point, which I did on one of my pencils, I don't want, oh, it was a green one, I think. Just bear me 2 seconds. It was, I don't know which one it was. But there's no need to, you know, you can get some, by very carefully using it, you can get a sharp, a flat facet for flat work, and you can get sharp edges for really crisp lines. Normally when you're shading or colouring in, you don't want hard lines. So I've just decided that I bought this last year, so I thought I would have a play in my Joanna. This is last year's attempt, and I've only just recently done this because I didn't know what to do with it. And I've also decided that I'm going to start at the beginning of a book. That's my new thing. I start at the beginning, then I don't miss pages. I've gone through to do lots of other things in here, but I decided if you start at the beginning, you can work your way through the book, and then when you get to the last page, you know you've done them all. So this is what it looked like before I altered it to look like this. So I took a tracing. I traced a few baubles. I've traced the deer from another page, and rearranged things, flipped things over. And I've got this as a reference with baubles to go on to other pages. And I filled the page out a bit, so I've got some little tiny stags down there. I filled the middle in because, again, absolutely love this paper, but it's, just blow me 2 seconds, I've lost my zoom out. Absolutely love this ivory paper. And I don't want to put a background on. I've learned to do backgrounds now, but I don't really want to put a background on. I just want it to be really, really lovely and soft. Very similar to this one. This one. This is an altered one as well. And I really like the fact that the ivory paper is behind it, just left. This one I altered. So I love the ivory paper, this one I've altered, but I just feel that I like a bit more on my page, so that I don't need to do a background and I don't have to mess about flooding the page with water and ruining the book. So I've altered quite a few, and all I'm doing is tracing. I'm tracing the pages of Joanna's, because I can't draw like Joanna. She's right-handed, I'm left-handed, so I thought I would have a bit of a play. I think I altered that one a little bit as well. So new colours, you change over the year, the colours, my colours have changed a bit, so So that's where we are. That's what it looks like now. I could add to it later if I want to. I think I want something here, but I haven't decided. I was thinking about holly, but then it doesn't, it's not incorporated with holly. So it'd have to be some beads or something else just dangling down. Maybe something here. But for the moment, that's what I've done. Traced it just with a 2B pencil. I happen to use the G Plus Faber-Castell because it's very good for fingers. They don't work well. And then I've used my rotary pen, which I haven't used it for months. Opened it and it just drew, so I love it. It happens to match the 0.25 matches Joanna's actual lines, so it doesn't look too far out. Some of the books are a little bit thicker, so I have to go up to a 0.35. It's permanent Indian ink, perfect for watercolours. And then I've got my new Derwent pencils, so I thought I'd have a play. But before I start on this page, I'm out of practice doing Christmas baubles, so I'm having a bit of a play with the cover. Now, my old cover fell off because I was just doing nothing but pages and pages with it of practice. So I've just had a bit of a play. So this is the Derwent watercolour pencil without being activated with water. And I'll zoom in, and you can see exactly what I'm doing, hopefully. Oh, hi, Mel. Welcome to Bunny's Designs. Anybody else popping in? Say hi if I've missed you, and pop it in caps, and I'll catch you. This is a live stream on Thursday. Miserable in the UK, cold and windy and rain. It's not too windy, not too rainy, but it's windy, sorry. A bit of sunshine out there. So this particular one is light violet, and I've done three colours. I've done three shades, sorry. So again, the pencil's not overly sharp. Don't need a sharp point. Every time you sharpen your pencil, you're ruining this professional watercolour that's in here. And I'm going to be using these a lot because I'm going to use them for watercolours. I'm going to be using them for professional watercolours that I'm going to be doing, and prove that you have a pencil that will be a pencil and you can blend with it. You can use it as a watercolour in a book, or you can scratch colour into a well and make a wash when you're doing professional watercolours on watercolour paper. And you can also make splatters and all sorts of wonderful different effects just from a pencil. So really, really like this. So although I've got 72, I've got literally 72 tubes of paint, and I love that. So I've been over once and then again and then just gently gone over, and I can't press hard, so just very soft. You don't want I wanted that light, didn't I? Don't want too much, but you can just appreciate the bit of highlight. That's just one color. Now you can mix other colors if you want to. I might just, but what I want to show is if you put a bit of yellow in that, and I'm a bit off with my yellows and things at the minute, so I'm going to use a primrose, I think. I'm going to use the zinc yellow number one, and I'm just going to put a touch of that over there. And you wouldn't believe what putting yellow to purple will do. It'll dull it, and it will make, where's my, here, it dulls it. So if I just show you this really quickly, sorry about the page flap. This is Karen Dashnier Colour 2s. And what I've done is I've mixed them with their complementary colour. So I've scratched a bit of red, then I've scratched a bit of green. There is a video on this, there's a couple of videos. And what you do then, so where the green is and the red is, you touch one and then you go over the green. And by the time you've gone over the green, you've given a bit of red to it, which has grunged it up, made it a shadow colour. And then you've got the green on there and you go back. Now you can only do it once. If you do it twice, you're mixing the colours together, you'll end up with a colour. I mean, I was only practicing. Eventually, you end up with a mud colour. But the idea is complementary colours will give you a gorgeous natural shadow or a darker tone. So here you can see those. There's no different colours. There's the bright green from the Neos and the bright red. You can just see it. But when you mix them together, if you do it very cleverly here, you've got a grunge. If you mix it too much, you get the grey. And this is what this one, this is greys. This is mixing complementary colours together to make greys. Slightly more yellow, I've got a greeny grey. Bit more blue, I've got a blue grey. Bit more purple, I've got a purple grey. So greys are gorgeous things for tonal shadows without adding Payne's grey to anything. So all these colours have all been made with complementary colours. So by touching a little bit of yellow in there, and you can put it in first, you probably want to put it in first. And Rembrandt used to do that for slightly different, same technique, but slightly different reason. He used to put red on the face, under the nose and the eyelids, before he put the flesh tone on, because your skin is thinner there and you can see the blood underneath it. So that's what he did. Very similar effect is that yellow will now disappear, but it's given a bit of a tonal value, a bit of a darker tone. And whoever thought that yellow would make purple dark. So we'll just very gently take that down because we don't really want to have it too much, but we're in a natural blend.
Do you want a drink at all?
Yes, please, Sonny, thank you. And you could leave it like that and just use these. And the other beauty of these pencils is you can use them as a pencil. You can blend the colours together and use them for a pencil, which I will be doing. I think I might be using these for quite a few weeks. If you think, oh, I could have done with a little bit more of a highlight, take your eraser, make sure it's clean, which has got some pencil on it, and you want a sharp edge, if you want a sharp edge, and then what you can do is... just take that off. And a highlight always looks brighter if you have it next to a darker. So I did touch that over. I'm just going to go back over there a little bit. And again, don't press hard. And your shadow will look darker because it's next to a highlight, and your highlight will look lighter because it's next to a shadow. So that's given quite a nice effect. Oh, happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Yes, welcome to... Yeah, I keep forgetting it's nearer and nearer. And then it's upon us. Again, you can do the purple top, or you can do it a different colour. And if you wanted, you could get a highlight on that. Now, once you've activated these with water, put a little highlight on the top. They're a little bit more difficult to manoeuvre. So that's a pencil. Oops, my camera wants to flash out. A little bit of a highlight, but it is a soft colour, that. If you were using a darker colour, you'd get a lot more of a tonal difference. And then with the number one little brush, oops, oh gosh, my new microphone is in the way. I say new microphone, it's new to me. I bought this to make my things better. and it won't work. And when I went to pick the laptop up, the gentleman gave me this. Bless his socks, he gave me a little Logitech. So that's what that is, if you ever see that sticking into the view. So here we have the highlight. Start with the lightest, very gently. And then I'm going to do them one at a time. Take that up. And then clean the little tiny bit off. I love this because that's all you waste. If you were doing this with a water brush, you'd be washing the brush away and all your colour would be going down the toilet. So, tight Yorkshire Lass. I love that. Now, if you work backwards, you can take that highlight backwards even more. And then just very carefully take that up to there. And just a bit of a dark at the bottom. Clean the brush. Again, the bottom highlight, take that up. And then you can really, really swish that and have a really gorgeous highlight. And these are light fast, they're professional watercolours and they are wonderful. So my highlight is on the outside a little bit because the light's coming from there. Now, you can leave this. And it's dried because we're not doing very much with it. What you can then do is to go back in. And I always suggest you do this off camera because if you flick, you will get colour everywhere, but obviously you can't see what I'm doing. And then we've got really, really strong pure colour there. Dab that in where you need it. And maybe just a bit down there. Clean the brush and then blend it gently so that you haven't got any harsh lines. But you've got a really nice effect. And it is really, really soft, that. It's a very, very soft. It's number 26, light violet. Now, I don't normally do very light colours, so I don't know what possessed me to do that, but I did. So we'll do a traditional red and green. So I've got the bottle green 43 and we'll have a nice red. We'll have a madder carmine. Oh, crimson lake. So we will choose our bauble. Just try to move things about a bit. I think we'll have a red background and green leaves. So very softly, and this is the very tall one, very pointed one that I've just sharpened. But I didn't put it into number two. I put it in number one and I took it to the edge, but I haven't taken the point because I don't need to take it to a point. It's fine. So just a very soft way of doing that. And then I'm so looking forward to being in the corner where nobody can disturb me. Nobody can find me and nobody can disturb me. And I use small circular motions, but you can do it however you want. But there's no point on this, so there's no sharp edges at the moment. I'm probably creating a sharp facet on the other side, but this is soft, so there'll be no lines. And you do this with your inkpens, pencils, and you don't have lines. So that's one flat layer of colour. And then we have maybe a little bit more here. At this point, I could probably put a little tiny little bit of red. Just the tiniest bit. So you can just barely see that, but you can see it. You can see it. It is red. And then we'll go back over there again to soften that red with the green. And then kind of round a bit. But again, not pressing on hard, just getting another coat and leaving the middle bit. I think that might actually be darker there. And that red has almost disappeared, but it's given us a shadow because complementary colours create shadows. Now, ideally, I need to turn that round because it's got to be easy for the hands. Very, very soft over the red, and that red has almost disappeared. But it's given a really nice, deep, rich tonal value to the. So, again, another little bit of here. Again, this is the third coat. So by the time you've got to the third coat, and I do this with the pencil sketchings I was doing, you know, one light, soft, grainy pencil shading. Then you go over again, little bit, leave the highlights alone and build up. And then finally you go back in and another layer. And that's going to give you really nice highlight. So I'm going to leave that one alone for the minute. And again here, just a soft amount. And if you want to leave a particular space, you could leave it completely white. Now, if you have a long point, you can use the side like this, but I'm just very carefully scratching the surface. Now I have noticed a bit of a difference between the old Derwent watercolour pencils that are almost vintage, I would think, these days, to the new ones. The new ones feel a little bit scratchy, but that's only to be understood. Different chemicals are now not allowed, things have changed. It's nothing to do with the worse pencils or they're not as good. It's to do with the fact that different things are being used, different wood is being used to save our forests, things like that. But when I've used them, I did a comparison, the colours seem to me exactly the same. So you can just hear these scratch more. That's the only difference I've noticed. When you use the other ones, you can't hear them. They've obviously got a little bit more wax. I remember watching the Derwent watercolour pencil factory video, and it said that when they've coloured, they're dried. Manufacturing's probably changed as well. So when they're dried, they're dipped in a wax for a few hours so that they're easy to flow onto your page. And again, manufacturing's changed, lots of things have changed, so not necessarily they are worse, they're just slightly different. So if you see the pale blue coloured pencil, you know that it's an older version. So the pale ones are the older version, this is the new version, the blue. So again, building up and building up. Now I didn't put the green on there, I forgot, so just a little touch of green. I mean, you can blend these pencils, and what happens is, I think, you put colour down and then the other pencil that you use blends the first one. I don't think it's a case of you need a blending tool. They kind of do blend quite nicely. So as you can see, I've built up a bit of green there now. I'm going to go back over with the red and experiment with different reds and different greens. This one is a kind of not a fake green, it's bottle green number 43, but it's not an olive. If it was an orange, I might have done a reddy orangey red rather than a pinky red, but I just thought I'd try this. But try different colors. Different reds go with different greens and will give you different shadows and tonal things. It's always nice to experiment. Now, I do have a bit of a problem with holding a pencil, so we're getting to the edge where it's not nice. This is why I don't do this very often. In fact, I never do this, but sometimes you just have to. I think I want the highlight up there. So again, I want the highlight up there, so I have to make this dark. I have to make it slightly darker because... But you need to do it in stages. Now, I don't work in pencil, so this may not be the right technique, but it seems to work with these watercolour pencils. And then you could maybe have a bit of a shadow under there if you wanted. Never going near this section because this is one pale. So we seem to have got a really nice tonal effect. Now there's no water on there yet, so I can take the eraser, make sure it's clean. If you want a sharp one, you need to use the a new eraser, but then I go back to soft ones and just kind of take that where you want. And if you carry on, you'll never get rid of this, but you will soften it so it makes a brighter one. And then you've got red on there, so you've got to be a bit careful. Now this is what I can't do, is just in there, take that off. So that's given us a really gorgeous highlight. They're not so bad. Yes, I'm not putting any pressure at all. Yeah. Kenny says, are the pencils that smooth? They are. They're just kind of building up the colour shades very carefully, with hardly any pressure whatsoever. I want to keep that highlight if I can. So you can just very gently go there again, just that little bit. Every time you do it gently, you're just adding a layer, probably about 4 or 5 layers. Then I would think you're kind of just rubbing on rubbing kind of thing, which is why that red really makes a difference. It grunges up that edge, so that makes the rest of the red pop its natural colour, which it normally would do anyway. So that's just using those as a pencil. Now what we can do is we can take this again, squeeze it, and then when water comes out, I take it off. It's barely damp, and you can do this for most watercolour books. So we're going to start here because we don't have any colour here, and then we're going to take this down because we can't go back. If we go back now, we've got colour on this. So we're going to just follow it round, and then when you get it to be kind of dark, we can go back in here. And then all this should be the right tone now. Think round. And then what's happened now is we now have a green watercolour, sorry, a red watercolour with a touch of green. If you were doing this with watercolour, you would have made your red and you would have your green. And it happens to be that green. You can use a different green, but just a touch of that onto your red, next to your red, and then just take a little bit at a time till they get your tone that you want. Now I have to clean this because it's there, but I love the fact that's all I've washed. If you were using watercolours, you'd be washing your colours down the drain, and you've got a mess. This way you don't have a mess. I've done that wrong with talking, so just do that. So again, back into here, staying away from that highlight because we don't want to touch it. Taking that colour up to there. And just activating that. And then you can't work back because we're going to take that away. So what we need to do is clean the brush. And then go back into the white and then take that watercolour back. Remember, this is a watercolour now. It's a pure professional watercolour and it will do exactly what watercolours will do. So you can reseed this. You've just got to make sure you do not touch that white. You've got to clean your brush every time to keep that wonderful, crisp, soft highlight. And then just work your way around. And this Derwent watercolour brush number one is the driest, and actually if you don't activate the tip too much, you tend to get a very just barely damp brush, which is wonderful. So we're just going to take that down to there, and then that's all you've wasted. So you have a really nice highlight. Excuse me. So again, start here and work back, and I got a little bit of red in there, but remember, this is a watercolour, so you could, with a clean tissue, take it out, but I don't want it too much because I want that to look, excuse me, I want that to look like a velvety or a dull matte, and I want that to be shiny, but it still would have a natural highlight because it's on a curve. So again, light, take that right down. So now that tiny touch of red in the green has now darkened that, not quite naturally. Excuse me. Quick slurp. So again, where it's the lightest first, then activate that colour. Now, the highlight's at the top, so I wasn't bothered about this bottom bit here. Excuse me. And take that up there, so that red is going to mix with that green up there. And just keep doing that. You've done all the hard work. You're just manipulating it. So what you could do, oh, excuse me. You could scratch your colour in with your pencils, the whole book, like I'm doing with the Hannah Carlson. And then you don't activate it to make sure it looks okay. You just go Now, the only difference is you can't do what I'm going to do next. You would get to this point and think, well, actually, I think I want a bit more dark there. But you can do that with just a water brush. So you can do it on the plane. And you'll have thousands of colours in your colour book. And you're activating them with a brush. So, quite like that. But I think, well, I'd like a little bit more dark green. So you can either put a touch of red here. And then you want a touch of green. And again, you do that off your page, really, because you'll splatter it. Now, one thing you can't do is you can't take it off with an eraser now, because it's now a watercolour. But being a watercolour, it means that you can wait for this to dry and come back to it another day and go in again and darken the darks and lighten the shadows. You see, it's a watercolour. So you can make it come alive. Now, in order for that to look even lighter, that has to look even darker, because that's dark and that's the light's on this section, so the dark would be down here. So this wants to be quite dark. So again, you can do it on this because it's the cover. You wouldn't be able to do this on a colour page. You would have trashed your page by now. But you can do this on watercolour paper. But it's a really nice, easy way to work. So I've got a couple of baubles there. Which look quite nice. And that's with the Derwent watercolour pencils. And the Derwent No. 1 watercolour brush. Thanks for watching.